the times in your life when everything is going well. Anybody ever have seasons in your life where everything is going well? Things seem to be going so good, you're worried and you're wondering. We all have those moments when things are perfect, when things seem to be flowing in our lives, when everything seems to be going our way and everything is coming up roses. We have those moments. But how many of you know that in just a moment, that can change? In just a moment, that can be altered and that can be different. There are times in our lives when life is challenging. There are times in our lives when life just gets downright messy. And we don't know how to handle some of the things that we come up against. We don't know how to deal with some of the things. And very often, discouragement can so easily settle into our spirit. Discouragement, depression, worry, fear, doubt, all of those things can get in our hearts. You know, I was reading some statistics the other day that said 20 to 25 million Americans every year deal with depression, severe depression in their lives. And I'm not talking about just, I'm having a rainy day. I'm having a gloomy day. I'm having an off day. I'm talking about severe depression that affects the quality of their life on so many levels. And we have all dealt with depression at some point in our lives. And at this season of the year, I am told that depression strikes people more than at any other time of the year during the holiday seasons. Some of them because they've lost so much over the year. Maybe they've lost a loved one, or they're grieving, or they're hurting. Some of them simply because of past hurts or things that just come up over the holidays, and they see their friends with all of their families and they're like, I don't have a family. I don't have anybody that I'm close to. And depression, discouragement settles in. Did you know that that happens also in corporate settings? The atmosphere can be set as one of depression or worry or fear or discouragement, even during the holiday season. And so how do we deal with that in our hearts and our lives? You know, I am very blessed because I just came from a family gathering over this past week that always blesses my heart. And I am very, very, very blessed and very thankful to have a family that still loves to get together and that actually still likes each other. And an extended family. I mean, we probably had 30 to 35 people at our Thanksgiving get-together. And it was outside. We had tables set up. And there was a bounce house, y'all. How many of you know that if there's a bounce house, you got to get in the bounce house? No matter what age you are, you have to get in the bounce house. Listen, all of a sudden, you become a kid again when you get in the bounce house. Until the food you just ate before you got in the bounce house strikes back. I told them at our family get together, I said, you know, I think there needs to be a rule, kind of like with swimming. You wait 30 minutes after you eat before you go swimming. You have to wait 30 minutes after you eat before you go in the bounce house because it's just not a good idea. But I got in that bounce house and I showed those kids a few things. Yeah, I did. I did. But it's funny. Go ahead, record. I don't care. Oh, you have video? Yeah, well, we'll go to the video in just a minute and I'll show you. But you get in there and probably, maybe not for you, maybe you're not a bounce house person, but you get in there and all of a sudden you become a kid again and you just have fun. Especially if there's kids in there with you and they're bouncing and you're trying to do different things, you just forget about everything else, all of the worries, all of the anxieties, all the stress. It just goes out because you're in a bounce house, and that's what you did. Too bad life can't be a bounce house, right? Some of us would be on vertigo trips all of our lives if life was a bounce house. But it could still be a beautiful thing, right? Right? But we're talking about encouraging ourselves. And that the enemy uses the tool of discouragement in our lives so powerfully against so many people. And I want to read a passage of scripture to you this morning that's found in 1 Samuel chapter 30 that talks about a moment in a guy's life that could have been the ultimate discouragement and what he did about it. In this passage of scripture, we learn about David, starting in verse 3. It says, so David and his men came to the city, and there it was, burned with fire. And their wives, their sons, and their daughters had been taken captive. Then David and the people who were with him lifted up their voices and wept until they had no more power to weep. And David's two wives, Ahinoam the Jezreelitess, and Abigail, the widow of Nabal, the Carmelite, had been taken captive. Now David was greatly distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and his daughters. But David strengthened, David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. And I want to stop right there for just a moment. Every one of us will experience troubles in our life. We will all go through troubling times, times where trials come in one right after the other, and it seems like it never lets up. I'm not going to stand here and tell you you're never going to have any problems, you're never going to have any trials, but what you do in the midst of those speaks volumes about your relationship with God, and it's important what you do in the midst of those. Let me give you a little bit of a backstory to what happened here, because I believe in context, and I believe we have to take scripture in context. The backstory of this story is that David is actually on the run from King Saul, who is the king of Israel. And David has, in the midst of running from Saul, because Saul is angry at him and trying to take David's life, David and his band of merry men, so to speak, who were his army, he had about 600 of them, David and his men went and aligned themselves with the Philistines to fight against the armies that the Philistines fought against. All the while, David keeping Saul in his peripheral vision. And in the midst of all of that, David asked the king of the Philistines to give him a city that would be a refuge city for David and his men. And the king gave David Ziklag. And David ruled, so to speak, in Ziklag as the leader in that city. And so at one point, David and his men, who had become mercenaries for the Philistine army, were out fighting with the Philistine army against the Amalekites and the other enemies of the Philistines. And there came a moment where the Philistines were going to change their site of direction, and they were going to fight against Israel. And David and his men stepped away from the fight in that moment, and they went back to the city of Ziklag to regroup and refresh, because David didn't want to fight against Israel. David already had been anointed king. Do you remember the story of when Samuel came and anointed David as king because the heart of Saul was now wicked and in rebellion against God? And God will not allow leadership that is in rebellion against him to maintain the anointing. And so the anointing had been lifted off of Saul and put on David in that moment. And later David would fight some battles that would get him recognized as a great warrior in Israel. He fought and he'd slayed the giant Goliath and cut his head off with his own sword. And he was popular in Israel after that because of the victory that God had given him. And they were singing songs about David. Songs of his triumph, songs of his conquest, songs of how amazing he was. You want to be encouraged? Have people write good songs about you and sing them. Chuck, I'm going to need you to write a couple of good songs about me. Sing them next Sunday, okay? All right, yeah. No, I'm afraid of what you would write. I'm scared of what you'd write. But David found himself in the midst of all of this, and it seemed like God was just blessing and blessing and blessing every endeavor that David did, until the heart of Saul became angry against David, and then David went on a run for his life. And now we find him in this moment aligned with the enemies of God, and yet he steps back from that moment because still he has the principle in his heart and in his mind, I will not touch God's anointed. See, David had opportunities to kill Saul, but he would not. David had opportunities to take the throne from Saul, but he would not. And in this moment, something catastrophic happened that could have leveled David's life and caused David to question God and to even doubt the anointing of God on his life. I want you to hear this because God has a calling on your life, and God has a purpose and a plan for your life. God has an anointing upon you for what he has placed you here to do. Now, the enemy is going to dog your steps. He's going to do everything he can to try to steal from you and to break that anointing, even if he has to use discouragement to do it. But you encourage yourself in God. You strengthen yourself in the anointing that God has placed upon you, and watch what God is going to do. This, as we read this story, David and his men pulled away from the army that the Philistines, as they were going to fight against Israel. And they went back to Ziklag to refresh and regroup and to just be with their families, because that's where their wives were, that's where their children were, that's where their homes and their cattle and everything was. So here are these men, and they're going back expecting to find times of rest, to find good meals, to find their spouses and their children. And instead, they come to the city, and the Amalekites have come into Ziklag while they were gone and destroyed everything. Burned the city to the ground. Took captive the women and children and all of the cattle and all of the herds and all of the flocks. Took them all away. They didn't kill anything. They just took them as their own. Listen, I want you to hear my voice this morning. The devil is coming after what God has given you. The devil is coming after your anointing. He's coming after your family. He's coming after your relationships. He's coming after your ministry. He's coming after everything with which God has blessed you and anointed you, because he doesn't want you to walk in that anointing. And if he can discourage you to the place that you stop and you give up, then he's won. We've all been to that place. We've all been to those moments where discouragement settled into us. I'm sure you have. I know I have. Those moments when discouragement was so crushing and so humbling, and you just couldn't seem to shake it. The scripture says that in this moment, discouragement settled in on not just David, but on every warrior that was with David. You've got to understand, these men that were with David, they weren't sissies. They were warriors. They were fighters. And yet in that moment of discouragement and loss, the scripture says they cried until they couldn't cry anymore. They were so broken and so hurt and so devastated that they wanted to just absolutely give up. And think about this for a moment, because in that scenario, David found himself not only discouraged and broken, but he found himself at odds with those who should have been on his side. Amen. Because those men who had fought valiantly with him, those men who had been his friend on the battlefield as well as in the city, those men that he had eaten dinner with, those men that he had fellowshipped with, those men he had trained with, those men that were like brothers to him, now, because of this situation, they turned it around and they looked at David and said, "We're going to stone you. It's over for you." Can you imagine the weight that is on David at this moment? Because not only are his wives gone, his children are gone, everything he owned is gone, his home is burned to the ground. And now the people he thought were closest to him are ready to kill him. Listen, there are times in your life when the enemy's going to strip everything away from you. And the people you thought were closest to you, you're going to find, want your demise. They want you gone. They'll talk about you behind your back. They'll gossip about you. They'll run you into the ground. They'll do all of these things. And in that moment, what are you going to do with that? Because how you respond to that is powerful, and it can change everything. If you give in to discouragement and you let discouragement steal the anointing of God on your life, then you will lose everything. David found himself in the balance in this moment. This was one of those defining moments for David. Here he was with the weight of everything that's happened. I mean, he had persuaded and influenced these men to leave their city and go and fight with the Philistines, who they weren't even really aligned with. I mean, they were really enemies, so to speak. Because it was a Philistine that David killed on that hill that day and cut off his head. And yet David had persuaded his men in that moment to leave everything and go and fight. And they did, because they trusted David and they believed David. And they believed the anointing that was on David's life. And so they did. And when they came back and saw that, all of a sudden, it felt like trust had been stripped away. It felt like they had been betrayed and that David wasn't the leader he was supposed to be. And David found himself with the weight of this upon him. And I want you to see a couple of things here that happened in the life of David that changed everything. This man named David, the scripture says that in verse 6 there, that he encouraged himself in the Lord. He strengthened himself in the Lord. He didn't go looking for an ally amongst the warriors who would be on his side and talk everybody else into not stoning him. David began to encourage himself in the Lord. I don't know what he did to do that, but knowing David, he was not only a warrior, but he was a worshiper at heart. He learned how to worship. He was a writer of psalms. He was a harpist. He was a musician. He knew what it was to come into the presence of God and to be alone with God. And in that moment, perhaps David recalled to his mind some of the psalms that he had written about the faithfulness of God and that God is a strong tower and we run into him and we are safe. Maybe he recalled to his mind some of the psalms that he had written about, I cry out to the rock who is higher than I am. And David began to encourage himself in the Lord. Listen, when the battles of life begin to beat you up, when the storms of life begin to blow you over, when the waves of life begin to take you under, you don't need to be aligning yourself with anybody but God. And the scripture says that before David went to war, he went to worship. He began to encourage himself. So often we're ready to just fight. When somebody messes with us or something doesn't go our way or something doesn't pan out the way we thought it was going to pan out, we're ready to just get up and fight and do what we think we should do. But David encouraged himself. You see, you should never engage the enemy when you're discouraged. Encourage yourself in the Lord. Encourage yourself, not by positive reading, not by podcasts that are going to speak it to your life. All of those things are great. Not by listening to a preacher who is eloquently going to share the word of God with you. Sometimes there's nobody but just you and God. And in those moments, you have to just begin to worship. David began to worship before he even inquired of God. David began to tell God how worthy God is. How many of us in those moments of devastation, in those moments of absolute loss, can turn our eyes to the heaven and say, God, you're still worthy. God, you're still holy. God, you're still faithful. In those moments where we've lost jobs, can we still say, God, you're faithful? In those moments where we've lost loved ones, can we still say, God, you're worthy? Think about Job for a moment. When Job went through everything Job went through, and God allowed the enemy to come in and test Job. Think about Job. He worshiped God still. He worshiped God in the midst of it all. Even when those closest to him said, why don't you just deny Christ and die? Why don't you just deny God and die? His own wife came to him and said that. And yet Job held on to who God was. See, I believe God knew the heart of Job. And I believe God knew the heart of David. And just as a point of fact, while David and the men were off fighting with the Philistines, Don't you know that God was powerful enough to protect the city of Ziklag had he chosen to? But there are times where God will allow things into your life to test your mettle. You know what I mean by that? To test who you are. And perhaps this was one of the testings of David's anointing to see what David was going to do. Because when Saul was confronted with issues, what did he do? He inquired of a witch. He went to a medium. He sought divination in other areas. And so now perhaps God was testing what David was going to do in this moment. Because it's interesting, when the Amalekites came in, they didn't kill anybody. They didn't even kill any of the cattle or the herds. They just took them. If they wanted to really destroy and devastate, then David and his men would have come back and found their wives killed, their children killed, everybody killed. So I believe this was a testing ground for David. In those moments of discouragement in your life, stop looking at it as though God is trying to destroy you. And begin to look at it as, God, what are you trying to teach me through this? What are you growing in me through this? Because when we begin to see it in that light, we begin to see it as a way of God testing us. Now, as I spoke a couple Wednesday nights ago, God never tempts us to evil, but God will put us through testing seasons. He will put us through moments where we have to decide, what am I going to do? And David, in this moment, decided, I'm going to encourage myself in the Lord. When I've got nothing else, I have God. When nothing else is going my way and nothing else is working, I will seek God. And the scripture says that he began to encourage himself and he began to strengthen himself in the Lord. That has to be the starting place. Strengthening ourselves in the Lord. And then look what David did. He took the time to worship. He took the time to encourage himself in the Lord. But then the scripture says that he looked at the priest and he said, bring me the ephod. Bring that ephod to me. That was the vest that the priests would wear. And that vest what became symbolic of the presence of God. And so David was saying, bring me the presence of God. Bring me that ephod that I can inquire of God what his desire is. So I want you to see the progress, the process here that David goes through. He begins to worship. Perhaps in that moment, he reminds God of his faithfulness, of the faithfulness that God has given him and placed in his life, of the times that God has brought him through, the moments that he slayed the giant, he slayed the bear and the lion, the moments that he delivered David from the arrow and the spear of King Saul, the moments that God has preserved his life, the moments that God put his anointing on David, and what David felt in that moment as God poured out the oil upon his life. And David began to encourage himself. And then, in that attitude of worship, he inquired of God, what would you have me to do? What am I supposed to do here? See, there becomes moments in our lives where we don't have an answer, where we don't know what is the right thing, when we have no clear direction. And perhaps our heart is so broken and our spirit is so devastated that we can't even imagine what to do. And in that moment, David worshiped and he inquired of God. He said, God, what am I supposed to do? I can hear the heart of David as his heart was not just for his loss, but the loss of all these men and the whole city over which he had leadership. And his heart cried out because here is a man who is a shepherd at heart. And so it wasn't about him so much. It was about the flock. He was willing to protect his father's flock from the bear and the lion. And in this moment, perhaps David wasn't even grieved in his spirit for himself and his own losses, but over those that God had placed in his care who had lost so much. And David began to inquire of God and say, God, what do you want me to do here? And did you know that when you sincerely seek the heart of God and the direction of God, God will always answer. God will always answer. Now, y'all, I'm going to be honest. It won't always be immediate. But God will always answer in the right time and in the right way. There are moments that you will inquire and God may not answer immediately, and you may feel like God is late and behind schedule, when in reality, He's right on time. And you don't understand His timing. You don't understand why He doesn't answer when you think He's going to answer. But trust me, when you sincerely seek the heart of God, He will always hear your prayer and He will always answer. So be encouraged in that, if nothing else. I don't know everything you're going through in your life. I don't know every struggle you're dealing with and every problem, but I do know this. You serve a God who is worthy and powerful. I know this, we serve a God who always hears the cries of His people and who always answers. And the scripture said that David, in that moment, that David inquired of the Lord, and the Lord said, pursue them. Pursue them. And I don't know if you've ever had those moments where you felt stressed and weary and tired and just exhausted. And you don't know what to do, and all of a sudden you get a word from God, and you feel strength start to come back into you. Not just your physical body, but in your spirit man. Because sometimes if your spirit man is exhausted, your whole body is exhausted. If your mind is exhausted, if your heart is exhausted and grieving and sorrowful, it will show in everything else. But in just one word from God, it can change everything. It can change everything. Why? Because the Word of God is living and active. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. The Word of God is powerful enough to transform our hearts and our minds in just a split second. And the Word of the Lord came to David, and David listened. David listened. Are you listening? Anybody listening this morning? Yeah. Oh, okay, hallelujah. I know you're listening to me, but are you listening to God? Are you listening to the word of the Lord? Because I don't know what God is speaking to your spirit through this, but I know what God is speaking to my spirit in the midst of this. And I want you to know that when God speaks, you listen and you obey. Just real quickly, in a nutshell here, the scripture tells us as you read on in this chapter that David gathered the men, 600 of them, he gathered together, and they went to pursue the Amalekites to get back what the Amalekites had stolen from them. And the scripture said that they came to a brook, and there was 200 men that were so exhausted, physically, mentally, spiritually, emotionally exhausted, that they couldn't even cross the brook. And David said, you men stay here. And he took 400 men with him. It's kind of like when God whittled down the army of Gideon so that God would be given the glory. In this moment, God was doing something. He was setting them up for victory. I want you to know that in the midst of your defeat, maybe it's God setting you up for victory. Maybe it's God setting you up to be triumphant and to be victorious. And the scripture said that David and the men crossed, the 400 men crossed over the brook. The other 200 men stayed behind. And David and those 400 men pursued the Amalekites. And against all odds, because you know, it's not really odds when God is involved. God brings the right people at the right time to bring the right victory to His people. There was an Egyptian slave who was in the wilderness who had been left there by his master who was part of the Amalekite army. This slave, Egyptian slave, had gotten sick and the master left him behind. And David and his men came upon this Egyptian slave and they captured him. They began to feed him and the slave regained his strength. And David said, who are you? And he said, I'm an Egyptian and I'm a slave of the Amalekites. I was sick. My master left me here. And you know, it may have been one of those things where the master left the slave to die in the wilderness. Kind of like, Joseph's brother sold him into slavery and had put him in the pit and did all of this stuff. But yet God was working everything out. Listen, I don't care what obstacles you face or what difficulties you encounter. God is working it out for you. Do not be discouraged. Do not be dismayed or disheartened, because God has a way of even bringing those things and those people into your life that you never expected to be there, and they're going to be your answer. They're going to be your answer that you need to get you to your victory. Stop dismissing people that God brings into your life because they don't fit what you think the answer is going to be. David never imagined that the answer for his victory was going to come through an Egyptian slave who was sick and left to die in the wilderness, and yet there he was. God's timing and God's strategy is absolutely impeccable. David and his men found the Egyptian slave before he died, and they fed him. He regained his strength and his health. And David said, "Will you tell me where they are?" And the Egyptian said two things. "If you promise not to kill me, and if you promise not to give me back to my master," basically, "if you let me live and you give me my freedom, I'll tell you where they are." David said, "Deal." The scripture said that this Egyptian slave led them straight to where the Amalekites were. Now, you have to understand, there were thousands upon thousands of warriors in the Amalekite army. And here's David with his 400 men. Absolutely insurmountable odds, it seems, until you put God into the equation. Because when you put God into the equation, it doesn't matter if it's just God and you, you're going to be the majority. I can just, if we could peel back the curtain of the natural and see what was happening there, I believe we would have seen a legion of warrior angels that surrounded David and his men, because the anointing of God was on this man of God. And in the same way, whatever distress you're going through, whatever problem you're facing, whatever battle you are engaged in, if you could just take a moment and see, you're not in this alone. There's angel armies that are surrounding you right now as you go forward to engage the enemy. Because some of us, the enemy has stolen from. He's stolen your children, your grandchildren, your families. He's stolen your finances. He's stolen your income. He's stolen many things from us. When you begin to engage the enemy, you're going to be surprised that there's an angel army that surrounds you. And the scripture said that David, when he saw the Amalekites, he knew God is going to deliver them into our hand. I don't know exactly how. I don't know how difficult it's going to be, but I will engage this battle because my family is important enough for it, and the families of all those that God has placed me in charge of is important enough that this is necessary. See, sometimes you can't avoid spiritual warfare. Sometimes it's too important to pretend like it's not there. And in this moment, David realized the importance of what was happening. And he began to go as God directed him. And the scripture says that David and his 400 men attacked the army of the Amalekites and destroyed every single one of them, except for there were 400 young men who got on camels that belonged to the Amalekites and rode out of the city. Other than that, they completely destroyed the army of the Amalekites. And David and his men got back their wives, their children, their possessions, their herds, their cattle, every single thing, plus the spoils of the Amalekites. Everything that the Amalekites had came to David and his men. You talk about encouragement. We're always encouraged when we see victory, aren't we? We're always encouraged when we watch God come through. But what about when we're not seeing God move? What about when we don't feel God in our hearts and in our spirits the way we thought we would feel God? What about in those moments where we're struggling in our families or our jobs or even in our community? What about those moments where discouragement settles into a church or a congregation or a flock of people? What about those moments? What do we do then? I'll tell you what we do. We lay everything else aside and we begin to worship. I'll tell you what we do. We begin to ask of God and we listen. And we don't just hear the word of God, but we put it into action. Even if it means we go against the enemy and we have to engage spiritual warfare. You see, sometimes you will only get out of discouragement by standing up in the armor of God. And saying, no, devil, it's not okay for you to take what God has given me, and I'm taking it back. You see, the devil's a bully. The devil's a bully. They talk big. They act big. They act like they're tougher than you. But I want you to know something. You've been given every weapon you need to defeat the enemy. So stop being scared. Stop being afraid. Stop thinking that the enemy's allowed to come in and run over you. You are a mighty man and woman of God. And God has called you and God has anointed you just like he did David to be his hands and his feet and his voice. He's anointed you to be the man and woman of God that will stand up and say, no, no longer will I allow the enemy to do this. For far too long, the church has just been on the defensive trying to keep the enemy away from us when God has not called us to be on the defensive but on the offense. God has called us to go into the enemy's territory and snatch back what belongs to God. The scripture, the gates of hell shall not prevail against them, means we're going against the gates of hell with a battering ram of the Holy Spirit, and that gate cannot withstand the power of God and the anointing of God. Your family is far too important. Your church is far too important for us to walk in discouragement and dismay. It's a moment where we are to rise up. Listen, our nation is far too important for the church to sit back and allow the enemy to come in and steal and destroy and burn Ziklag. It's far too important. God has given us this. This is ours. So rise up. Encourage yourself in God. Strengthen yourself in worship and in the word of God. And when God speaks, move out. Move out. Even if he whittles you down, even if he prunes you back, it's okay. Because he's doing something that's taking you to victory. Even though God may bring things into your life or people into your life that don't seem to fit the narrative of the victory that God has placed in you, you still follow the plan of God. Because you have no idea who God is going to use to snatch you out of discouragement. Sometimes God uses people and things that seem foolish to us. Seems foolish to us. And we can even look down our nose at it and say it's not good enough. They're not good enough. They're an Egyptian slave who's sick and dying in the wilderness. How are they going to help me? And yet all along, God is ordering our steps to bring us to victory. So be encouraged this morning and be strengthened in your heart. This may be a time of year and a season of year, and honestly, 2020 has been brutal on all of us. 2020 has been like the Amalekites coming into Ziklag and burning our city. But perhaps this wasn't sent for our destruction before our victory. Perhaps this year wasn't sent to disable us, but to actually encourage us and strengthen us as we seek God. Because we are the church, and I'm speaking about the church at large. For those of you who are watching live stream, you are the church as well. We are the church. The oil of the Holy Spirit, the anointing of the Holy Spirit was poured out upon us just like it was upon David when God anointed him to be king. We walk in a power that very few actually tap into. That's the power of the Holy Spirit in the church today. And church, it's time for us to step out of discouragement and step into the power of God. And be encouraged in our hearts and in our spirits. Because although it may seem like destruction at this moment, we have to see the bigger picture. We have to see beyond that to see what God is going to bring out of this. Because the Word of God tells us He raises beauty from ashes. In Psalm, it tells us that weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Do you want some joy this morning? Do you want to be encouraged in your heart, in your spirit? I believe that God has brought us here for this moment because some of us have been dealing with discouragement. Some of us may have been dealing with depression. Some of us may have been struggling with grief that seems so overwhelming at times that we're not sure how we're going to get through it. And yet in those moments, God is calling us back to a place of worship and seeking Him. So through this, the rest of this holiday season and through the rest of this year, find your encouragement not in Christmas trees and presents, but find your encouragement in hearing the Word of God and doing the Word of God. Take the faith, take the step of faith to step out and do it, because faith without works is as useless as a screen door on a submarine. You've got to have works that accompany your faith to see the power of God. Would you stand with me this morning? And I want us to pray. And I want you to just, if you feel comfortable, take the hand of the one that's standing there beside you. We're not going to do a formal altar call this morning, but I want you to take the hand of the one who's standing there beside you. You may know what they're going through. You may not. You may be very close to them and still not know every struggle of their heart and their life. But I want you to pray for them this morning. And I don't want you to just pray a passive, memorized prayer. I want you to ask the Holy Spirit to lead you in praying for that one whose hand you're holding. Because there are times that the Holy Spirit will lead us in prayer. And we'll pray in ways that we didn't have any idea needed to be prayed. I want you to pray for them. I want you to speak encouragement and life into them. Because they may be looking at a Ziklag in their life where everything seems to have been destroyed and crumbled to the ground around them. For those of you who are watching live stream, grab somebody in your house. Take their hand. Or take your own hand. But I want you to pray. But before you pray for that person, I want you to take just a moment and worship God. Just tell God He's worthy. Just praise Him. Just exalt the name of Jesus. Would you join with me and let's do that? Father, today, I'm so thankful for You, Heavenly Father. For You are great and mighty to save. You have been faithful through every generation and through every moment of my life. You have always been faithful, God. And I exalt You today. I worship You and I glorify You because You are the strength of my life. You are the hope of my soul. Lord, I acknowledge You as the Holy One of Israel and as the Savior of my life. You're the power of God in me. You're the Holy Spirit who dwells within my heart and my life. You lead me and direct me into every truth. And I'm so thankful for You today, and I just want to worship You. I worship You, Lord, with everything that's in me. I lay it all down before You. I give glory to Your name, Jesus, for You alone are worthy. I exalt You today, Lord. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. You're the lover of my soul. You're the lifter of my head. You're the transformer of my mind. You're my everything, Jesus. You're my everything, Jesus. I can do nothing without you. And so today I look to you to be my help and my healer and my strength. I look to you to be my encouragement. I look to you to be that hope in my soul. Lord, I pray for my brothers and sisters who are in this place. I pray for my brothers and sisters who are watching this live stream or who will be watching this video later. Lord, I pray over them today. The enemy has come into their lives to try and steal. The enemy has come into their lives to try and destroy. But Lord, you have raised up a banner against him. You have put it in the hearts of your people to get up on our feet and to step out in anointing and to engage the enemy. And so right now, God, we seek your face for direction and for clarity for our families. We seek you for clarity and direction for our church. We seek you for clarity and direction in our community and our city and our nation, God. We cry out to you and we ask you to lead us and direct us. And Lord, as you speak your word over us, encourage us and strengthen us. Even though our situation may not change in the immediate, even though you may be calling us to a place of warfare and not a place of safety, Lord, even in the midst of all of that, strengthen us and encourage us. Show us your victory, God. Show us your plan and your purpose. You are everything, Lord. And we worship you today. Lord, we lift you up and we magnify you. Lord, I will sing praises to your name. I will exalt you. God, when I stand in moments in my lives in the middle of a burning Ziklag where everything's gone and I'm left with nothing, help me to turn my eyes to the heavens. Help me to not seek my answer among the things of this earth. But help me to focus my attention on you, God, and hear from you. And help me to move out accordingly. Follow your word with all of my heart and my strength. Lord, I love you today. And I bless you and I praise you. Exalt you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul, I live for you alone, every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake, Lord, have your way in me. This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. All I have within me, I give you praise. All that I adore is in you. Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake, Lord, have your way in me. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. My prayer over you this week is that you will be encouraged in your heart and in your spirit, and that the strength of God will fill you and move you forward. And even if you have to engage the enemy, that he will fall at your feet, helpless in the presence of God. Amen? Amen. Shake somebody's hand, hug somebody's neck. You are dismissed. God bless you. I hope you have a great week. Don't forget about Wednesday night. We're decorating the church. See you here.
My God.